Welcome to the Cambridge Financial Podcast with Bert Salazar, CEO at Cambridge Financial Partners, LLC. This podcast is all about tax-preferred retirement planning, economics, financial risk management, and achieving a risk-free and successful financial life. Now, your host, Bert Salazar. Bert Salazar.
Good day, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us for another Cambridge podcast. We didn't do a podcast last week. My wife had surgery last Wednesday, but she's doing much better. She's recovering every day. So thank you all for, you know, sending your thank yous and your well wishes and so forth. So I appreciate that very much on behalf of myself and that of my family. Today we're going to talk a little bit. It's going to be a short podcast because, you know, it's 2018. Obviously, the new tax law has just taken effect. So a lot of the clients that are coming in to do tax planning with me and with my firm are asking many questions as to the amount of contributions to IRAs, 401ks, SEPs, simples, other types of retirement plans, and so forth. So I thought it would be a good idea for us to kind of touch upon that and then figure out what are some of the things that are critical to remember as you start making your contributions for 2018 and beyond. So IRAs and employer-sponsored retirement plans are subject, obviously, to annual contribution limits, and they're set by the federal government on an annual basis. Now, the limits are usually adjusted to compensate for inflation and the increases in traditional cost of living and so forth. So, for instance, in 2018, and this goes back to 2016 and 2017 as well, you can contribute up to $5,500 to all IRAs, and that would be the combined limit based on inflation. So if you have two or three IRAs that you're contributing to, and I wouldn't understand the reason for doing something like that, especially when IRAs are so well diversified today, the maximum that an individual can contribute to an IRA would be $5,500. Now, if you have a traditional IRA as well, as a Roth IRA, you can only contribute the maximum of $5,500 for 1 year. So I do have clients, and one of the techniques that we use here at Cambridge is to make certain that our clients are maximizing their contributions to Roth IRAs and Roth 401ks and so forth. But many a times it makes sense to split the contribution. So we may put 55% of the IRA contribution to a traditional IRA, which means that the clients are taking a tax deduction today, and then the money is going to grow on a tax-deferred basis, and then all of it will be taxed at some point in time in the future. Or they can also opt in to do a 50% contribution to a Roth IRA where, no, you're not taking the tax deduction today, but then the money's going to grow tax-deferred, and you're going to be able to receive that income on a tax-free basis for the rest of your life. Now, whenever we do any type of IRA or pension or retirement planning, we take a look at provisional income calculations, and we do that because we want to make certain that traditional IRAs and traditional 401ks that our clients have in their investment portfolio are not so high that they're going to be and they're going to provide a tremendous negative triggering event from a tax perspective. And what do I mean by that? Well, you know, when a client reaches age 70 and a half, if you happen to have a traditional IRA or a traditional 401k, you need to start taking minimum distributions. And the minimum distributions, as we've talked in the past, are basically determined by the amount of money that you have in that qualified plan at the end of the year. And then you divide that by a formula that is based on your age and mortality. Now, if the required distribution is higher than all of the standard deductions and exemptions and credits that you may have in your tax return, not only is that distribution going to be taxable to you and to your family, but it may very well also cost your Social Security benefits to be taxed as well, and also your capital gains and ordinary dividend distributions. So, you know, distributions from a traditional IRA or a traditional 401k may actually create havoc when it comes to taxation in the future. So when we do planning for our clients, we want to make certain that we run net present value calculations to determine what would be a suitable amount to be contributing to an IRA today or a 401k in order for that distribution in the future not to be taxed and obviously not to create a tax liability on Social Security and other benefits as well. Now, for employer-sponsored retirement plans, such as 401ks, 403bs, if you happen to work in the public sector, for 2018, they have an $18,500 contribution limit. Individuals that happen to be age 50 and older can also contribute an extra $6,000 as a catch-up contribution. So if you are maxing out on your 401k or 403b, you may put away $18,500, but if you happen to be age 50 and above, you can add another $6,000 a contribution for a total maximum of $24,500. Now, that does not include the match that you may get from your employer if you happen to be in an employer sponsor plan that provides a matching as well. Now, also bear in mind that if you're contributing to an IRA and you happen to be age 50 or older, there's also a catch-up contribution that the IRS gives you access to, and that one would be $1,000. So if you're maxing out on your IRA and you're putting in $5,500 a year, and you happen to be age 50 and older, you can contribute an extra $1,000 for a total of $6,500. So you have to, again, be very careful because, you know, many of the challenges that we have here at Cambridge as we work with clients is trying to understand, you know, their thought process when it comes to IRA and qualified plan contributions. Many of them, actually, the majority of their retirement income planning is in traditional IRAs and 401ks, so they're going to have a very difficult time avoiding any of those booby traps and additional tax liabilities that we all want to avoid in the marketplace and during our retirement years. Now, distributions from traditional IRAs and most employer-sponsored retirement plans are taxed as ordinary income, you know, except for any after-tax contribution that a client or an investor may have made, and the taxable portion may be subject to a 10% federal income tax penalty if taken prior to age 59 and a half, and we'll talk a little bit about that in the next few minutes. Now, also bear in mind, and this is something that I see with many of my clients, if you happen to participate in both a traditional IRA and an employer sponsor plan, your IRA contributions may or may not be tax deductible depending on your adjusted gross income. And those are the calculations that we do when clients call us to see if they can still make a contribution to their, in this case, their 2017 IRA in 2018 prior to the filing of their income taxes. So obviously we do those calculations because we have to figure out what the adjustable gross income is. And because we do tax planning and we do tax preparation for our clients as well, we do have the formula and the ability to decipher what percentage of those contributions to IRAs would be tax deductible. So those are things that are very critical to understand from a business perspective. So I thought it would be a good idea to kind of discuss it today. Now, one of the things that is also important to take a look at is, you know, what happens if I or if you withdraw money from a tax deferred investment before the age of, you know, 59 and a half. Well, you know, withdrawing taxable funds from a tax deferred retirement account before the age of 59 and a half generally triggers a 10% federal income tax penalty on top, and that's on top of any federal income taxes that are due. Now, distributions from, you know, like Section 457 deferred compensation plans, you know, are generally not subject to an early distribution penalty. And the penalty for distributions from, let's say, simple plans, which are simple IRA plans that an employer may put together during the first 2 years of participation would be 25%. And then 10% thereafter. So if you happen to work for an employer, have a simple plan, and the simple plan was put together in less than 2 years, and you need to start taking some distributions, your penalty is not going to be 10%, it's going to be 25%. So you got to be very careful about that as well. Now, there are certain situations in which you're allowed to make early withdrawals from a retirement account and avoid the tax penalty. So the question is, well, what are some of those IRA exceptions? And some of them are, for instance, the death of an IRA owner. So any distributions that are designated for beneficiaries after the death of the owner of the IRA will not be subject to the 10% penalty. Now, the beneficiaries are subject to the annual required minimum distribution from these accounts, you know, after the passing of the IRA owner. Now, what if you happen to get disabled and you need to, you know, take money out of your IRA? Well, distributions made due to your qualifying disability do not, again, I repeat, have a 10% penalty attached to it. So death of an IRA owner, disability, you know, you're able to take distributions with no penalties. Also, you can avoid the 10% penalty for unreimbursed medical expenses, but obviously there's a formula on this one as well. So distributions equal to the amount of your unreimbursed medical expenses that exceed 10% of your adjusted gross income or your AGI in a calendar year could avoid that 10% penalty as well. Now, medical insurance. So if you're taking a distribution and you make that distribution in order to pay for health insurance, if you happen to have lost your job and are receiving unemployment benefits, then the IRS does allow you to take money out of those plans and avoid the 10% penalty. Now, always bear in mind that although you may be avoiding the 10% penalty, you're still paying regular income taxes on that distribution, and that would be based on your adjusted gross income and also based on the effective tax rate and or marginal tax rate that you have when you file your income taxes. There's another way that a number of my clients are utilizing, and this is a technique that is not very well known for your traditional American investor, and that's what we call the substantially equal periodic payments, or SEPs, as we call them. And basically what it is that distributions that you receive as a series of substantial equal payments over your life expectancy or the combined life expectancy of you and your beneficiary, you can withdraw those and avoid that 10% penalty. Now, there are some guidelines when it comes to taking these substantial and periodic distribution payments, and one of the guidelines is that you have to be able to withdraw the funds at least annually based on one of three I would say they're rather complicated IRS, you know, approved distribution methods, and that's something that we do for our clients when the time comes, if there is a necessity or if there's an investment opportunity to do so. Now, you generally can change or alter the payments for 5 years or until age 59 and a half, whichever occurs later. So let me give you an example. Let's say that I'm 55 years of age and I want to start taking distributions, regular distributions out of my IRA account. Basically, what the IRS says is, look, if you're going to do this on a one-time basis, then not only you're going to have to pay federal income taxes, but you're going to have to pay that 10% penalty. But if you continue to take the same amount of money out of this IRA, and you do this, you know, for many years down the line or several years down the line, you may very well avoid that 10% penalty. So if you happen to be age 55, remember the guideline says this has to be, you have to take it until age 59 and a half or 5 years, whichever is longer. So if you happen to be, let's say 55, then you would have to go to age 60. If you happen to be age 54, when you start taking these periodic distributions, you'll go to 59 and a half. If you happen to be age 58, then you'll have to go to age 63 in order to avoid those penalties. Now, once you hit either the 59 and a half or the 5 year, depending on which one is the longest in your particular situation, then obviously you can stop making the distributions if it's suitable for you, and you're not going to be compelled to any tax liability. Now, the other way that you can take money out without having to pay the 10% penalty would be for qualified higher education expenses, either for you and or your dependents. So you can take money out, obviously, and there are limits for that. And if you do that, then yes, you will pay federal income taxes on the amount of the distribution, but you're not going to have to pay taxes on the penalty for early distribution. If you happen to be a first time home purchase, you can take up to $10,000, and that would be a lifetime limit, and you can do so without having to pay the 10% penalty. And then obviously, if it's a qualified reservist distribution, certain distributions to qualified military reservist call to active duty may allow you, if you qualify properly, to take those distributions again without having to pay the 10% penalty. Now, one of the things, and for the employer plans is pretty much the same thing, you know, death, disability, if it's substantial and periodic distributions, there's a big difference in employer plan. Attainment of age 55. So if distributions made to you under a separation of service from your employer, the separation must have occurred during the calendar year in which you reached the age of 55. Now, if you happen to be a public safety employee, the age is age 50. So if you happen to be a public safety employee and you retire at the age of 50, you can start taking money out of your qualified plan and not have to pay the 10% penalty as you would otherwise in a traditional IRA. And if you happen to be an employer and you retired, but you're not a public safety employee, then the distribution or the 10% free distribution would start at age 55 instead of age 50. Also, there's another type of distribution, and this one we deal with on a regular basis, is what we call a quadro, which is a qualified domestic relations order. And that's where payments are made to an alternate payee in divorce proceedings. So if you are married and there's $500,000 in your qualified plan or 401k or whatever it may be, and a portion of that now belongs based on the agreement with your spouse or former spouse-to-be, you can take a distribution and do a direct transfer of a portion based on whatever was agreed upon to that other person, and then that portion would avoid the 10% penalty as well. Medical care, to reduce excess contributions, you can also avoid the penalty. And again, for qualified reservist distribution for those in the military, if they happen to be called to full-time duty and or active duty, and they have to separate from their employer for a given number of months of years, depending on the active duty requirement. Now, one of the other issues that is very critical to understand when you're putting money into qualified plans is the fact that there, you also have D7, D1/2 rule. So bear in mind that any distributions other than one, than the exceptions that we have mentioned, any distributions you take out of an IRA or a qualified plan prior to age 59 and a half, you're more than likely going to have to pay taxes, and on top of that, a 10% penalty. Now, if you happen to be in an employer-sponsored qualified plan, you do have the ability, as long as the plan document for that employer allows it, you could borrow money from your 401k, but then obviously there are certain guidelines as well. You have to be able to put the money back within 5 years. And obviously, as you pay the money back into that qualified plan, you're paying the money back with after-tax dollars. And yes, although the interest that is being charged will be added to your account, the fact that you're putting the money back that you borrowed on an after-tax dollars may create a double taxation, because when all the money goes back and then you finally retire, start taking distributions again, all of those dollars that you put back in based on the amount of money that you borrowed, you're going to have to pay taxes on that money all over again. So be very cognizant of the fact that whenever you start taking distributions out of qualified plans, you have to really understand the rules of engagement in order not to get into trouble. So bear in mind that in traditional qualified plans, whether they're IRAs or employer-sponsored plans, between the ages of 59 and a half and 70 and a half, you can do pretty much anything you want. Now, once you get to age 70 and a half, then there's something called the required minimum distribution, and again, it's based on the amount of money, as I said earlier, that you have in your accounts at the end of the year, and then obviously your age and your mortality table. Based on that, you use the formula, and then you have to take that amount as a minimum distribution. Yes, you can take more if you want, but the minimum distribution has to be that amount. And the reason why I mentioned that is that if you don't take that minimum distribution that you're required to take at age 70 and a half, not only are you going to have to pay taxes on the distribution that you took, that was less than the required amount, or if you decided not to take any distribution, not only will you have to pay taxes on that distribution, but you will also have to pay a 50, and I repeat, a 50% penalty on the amount of money that you should have taken out of the IRA or qualified plan that you didn't do. So be very careful with those types of planning from a business perspective. Most of the time, if you happen to be in a Roth IRA, in a Roth IRA or a Roth 401k, you do have the 59 and a half rule. And also you may have for the first 5 years contributions to a Roth IRA, you may have an extra penalty along those lines. But you don't have in Roth IRAs the 70 and a half rule. So one of the great techniques that we use with many of our clients is we split the contributions. We put a certain amount of contributions into a traditional IRA, depending on the income level of the client, and we have formulas that we figure out for our clients to do that. And then we put the rest of the money in Roth IRAs, Roth 401ks, and also PERP, which are the personal insurance and retirement program contracts that use the tax benefits of life insurance in order to create a tax-free retirement plan. Next week, I will be doing a podcast and also a webcast on the enormous benefits of creating a tax-free retirement plan for you and your family in the future. Now, obviously, I was just going through the debt clock that the U.S. government has put together for all of us, and you can just go online and take a look at it. And we're obviously just north of $20 trillion in debt. So although the 2017 Tax Cuts and Jobs Act of President Donald Trump is providing some relief at this point in time, bear in mind that on the individual side of the house, all of these tax benefits sunset in 8 years from now. So that means that in 8 years from now, it'll go back to the same rules that we had in 2017 prior to the new tax reform. Now, obviously, so that means that there's a very high probability that taxes in the future are going to be a lot higher than they are today. So you have to be able to plan properly. Now, by the same token, because there's an eight-year pretty much fire sale going on right now, it is critical that you start doing tax planning today, because if you wait a year or 2 years, and you're going to be way out of the ballpark when it comes to maximizing your tax preferred distributions in retirement. So it's a very exciting time. We're now starting to get very, very busy for tax season and also tax planning for our clients. So we're going to start talking about some of these issues in the upcoming podcast. So just stay tuned, and always remember that our number one goal at Cambridge, and my number one goal with each and every one of our listeners on the podcast, is to change the way that you see things. Because when you change the way that you see things, the things that you see change. So again, have a wonderful day, and we'll see you next week.